Hi, I'm Richard deCosta. I'm the lead composer for the Peace Island game. And this presentation is intended to show the methods that I use to create soundtracks for this particular game. If you look at the homepage here and you go to our soundtrack, you'll see what you kind of expect for just about any game. You have a list of songs. And while some of these will possibly make it into the game someday, most of them are not going to be in the game in this form. Like, for instance, this track right here is going to be in the game, but not in this form. This is a final mix. Two tracks. It's a stereo mix. There's a beginning, a middle, and an end. There's not much you can do to it in-game other than play it, stop it, play it slower or faster, I guess. Play a different song, play it louder or slower or softer. That's basically all you can do. Or switch to another track. You know, they're stereo tracks. So the idea with the Peace Island, soundtrack is to have a dynamic soundtrack that adapts to the game as you're playing it. So, for instance, you're in a situation where everything's pretty relaxed, your character's doing well, his health is high, her health is high, depending on which cat you get, their health is high. Then the music will reflect that. It'll be a fairly happy score, relatively speaking. And most of the music in this soundtrack is pretty dark. If you're doing the quests and you're playing the game, it's pretty dark stuff because you're on an island and all the people have disappeared. It's up to you to figure out where they went and if they should come back. So it's an abandoned island and you're walking around it as a cat slash cats. And the soundtrack's pretty dark. But within that general darkness, there is degrees. So that if your character is, for instance, just playing with something that they found. So your cat's walking along, goes into a building, and there's a ball on the floor. The cat can smack it. And it basically increases the health and the contentment of the cat. It also increases something called the activity level, which is internal to the game, but also, as we'll see later, there are some other parameters that control the soundtrack besides happiness, activity level, and the other one that we're using now, the third one, is the time of day. So the soundtrack will change if you go from day to night and back again. Now, the level of adaptability of the soundtrack using FMOD, which is what we're using, which I'm using, is incredibly flexible. You can have just a little bit of dynamic music where you can jump from one part of the song to another when an event happens, or when you go from one area to another, you can do that. But also, we can control the way the song is playing as it's playing. So let's say we're in a certain point in the game and the music is playing a fairly relaxed piece, and all of a sudden you're into some unknown or unexpected situation, and the soundtrack's going to change based on that. Like, say you've encountered the geese and all of a sudden your happiness level goes down because the geese are going to harass you because that's their job. So your happiness level starts to go down, and the soundtrack will react to that. So in FMOD, we have the three parameters. We have the happiness. We have the, well, in the game, it's called contentness. I've been calling it happiness ever since I started using it. So you can also think of it as health, the general health parameter of the game. That is 0 to 100. The activity level, 0 to 100. And the hour, 0 to 24, 1 to 24. And in our particular EnviroSky setup, the daylight hours are from 0 to 11, and then night from 11 to 19, and then from 19 to 24 is daylight again. So when we go to FMOD, we'll need to know that. Okay, so let me give you an overview of how we're going to approach this. So some of the programs that I'm using to get this done, the first one obviously is the game engine itself, which is Unity, and this is the program that I use to test the demo. And what we have is a ball that we can drag around, and the only thing this does is it changes the activity level and happiness for the player. There's no player here, but we're going to pretend that there is. So essentially what's going to happen is I have this controller, and let's say we just had that situation where there's a goose and the cat runs into the goose, runs afoul of the goose. We can adjust this parameter so that the happiness level will go down. And when the geese go away and everybody's better again, we can bring it back up again. And the same with the activity level. And with this controller, we can do them both at the same time. Let me just play it for you. This is a soundtrack called Midlands, which is basically a fairly empty area. And I'll play that for you now. Okay. So the hour is 2, so we're not going to hear any changes in the soundtrack for time-based parameters quite yet. But in the inspector over here, I have the information as well. So this isn't going to change for 30 seconds. I'm going to increase that because I don't want the hour to change while I'm talking to you about other things. I don't want it to get to 11. Okay, so here's the important stuff right here, this ball in the middle. So right now you're hearing the soundtrack at a very neutral level. So our activity level and happiness is at about 50. When you start the game, you're actually going to start somewhere up here with happiness and activity level near the top, or possibly just the happiness level at the top and the activity midway through. And if you listen to the difference as I bring it down, the sounds change. They get darker and darker. And notice how slowly it can happen. Now in game, the happiness level, this right here, is going to be a bar up at the top. And it's only going to drop about 10% per minute or 5% per minute, depending. These are some of the details they're still working out in the game. So it's going to be dropping very slowly. If you move this around quickly, you get a very odd sounding soundtrack, and it's not supposed to do that. It's going to be moving very, very slowly. So these values are going to be changing about like this. So unless you're really paying attention, you may not even notice the soundtrack changing because it's going to happen so gradually. But things are a bit exaggerated when we're developing in this. Okay, so that's our goal, is to create audio soundtrack that reacts to the parameters of the game. I'm not going to go over standalone events or one-shots or anything like that in this video. This is going to be purely about the soundtrack and the music. Okay, so let's take a look at how this is done. The only thing that's really happening in the Unity project right here is there is a score object which is linked to a FMOD Studio project. And I've written a little bit of code just to get us from those values and put them into FMOD so that it can adjust playback as necessary. And here are the four parameters that we're going to be using: happiness, activity level, hour, and smacks per minute, which is something that hasn't been implemented quite yet, but hopefully will soon. And basically all that means is as your cat is playing with something, every successful smack at something will make this tick up. And then in our special playtime music, which the cats will go into when they're doing nothing but playing, so they're off mission, they're off doing their own thing, they've found a bunch of toys and the cats are just, you know, whacking balls around and whatever, And the soundtrack will change from the current level, wherever you are, to the playtime soundtrack, which is a different event, a different song entirely. But it has its own dynamic levels, and so that will change based on some max per minute. And basically what happens is you start out with a fairly low-key playtime music, and then you end up with some really crazy, you know, cats gone bonkers music. And let me play a little bit of it. I won't go through what all this means right now, but this is FMOD, and this is the playtime music. So it's looping this one section, and this is all based on some max per minute. So if I increase that, it'll jump to the next busiest section. Whoops, I went over it. There's one in between. There we go. So based on some max per minute, your playtime music gets more and more crazy. And eventually, it becomes really crazy. Okay, so that is a one-parameter song. There's only one thing going on there. That the playhead is just moving around based on max per minute. But what I want to do now is show you an actual piece of music that is divided up into its component parts. And give you a little bit of an idea how that works. And this is the piece that we were looking at in Unity. So this is Midland, so I'll play it for you. And right now we're starting off with activity and happiness at 100 and 100, but let's move that down to 50 where we were before. So this should sound identical to where we were in Unity because they are the exact parameters, and this is the same exact project that Unity is using. So, I'm going to decrease the happiness, and you'll hear the same thing going on. You'll see some of the levels moving around as I do this. And actually, let's switch to the happiness tab here. And what these lines are, it basically represents, here is a single instrument. In this case, it's an arpeggio. I'll solo it so you can hear nothing but that. But it's not playing right now because these parameters that I've set make it so that this won't play until it gets to 47-ish or more. And then it will top out at this level here. This is the high arpeggio. This is only when the happiness level is really high. Then we have one that's mid. This is a mid-range arpeggio on the same notes. And that is played when the happiness level is between, well, 85-ish and down to the 20s level. 20 level. Now, if you play them both, as you move the happiness level up, you'll start to hear this one fade in. Now you hear them both. And then as you get higher and higher, the mid arpeggio will fade out and the high one will stay. And depending on how much of an effect you want there, you could even raise it at the last 5% of happiness there so that it goes up a lot more at the very end. So those are those two arpeggios. Now I have one more. I have a dark arpeggio. So we have a high, a medium, and a dark, or high, medium, and low. And let me play the low one by itself. And of course I need to be in somewhere in the timeline where the low arpeggio exists. And let's keep the hour back here, daytime. Okay, so there's the low arpeggio. If I solo the mid as well, notice that you don't hear it because the slider here, or the parameter is set to be very low. As we go up, the mid arpeggio will come in, the low will fade out. And then the same with the high. The low will fade out, the high will come up, and then eventually fade out. And those, the low is gone still. So at any point during this score, you're going to hear one of these three or a combination. You'll never hear more than three because at this point here, the only one playing is the mid. And here you're hearing the mid and the low, and here you're hearing the mid and the high. So if we repeat that process for the entire score, this is all of the instruments, and you don't necessarily have to change these values, like the crickets here. There's no automation for happiness on the crickets track. And the reason is that I want it to play no matter what the happiness and busyness level is. But it's only going to play at night. So if we're during the day here, we'll never hear the crickets. But if we go during the day, then we hear the crickets. And they're not really crickets. Actually, I may have changed the activity level on that. Let me see. Where are the crickets? Okay, yeah, I did change the activity level. So when the activity level is higher, then the crickets will fade in. So if we're moving around a lot at night, we're busy, then the activity level will come up and the crickets will fade in. Not really crickets. Well, they were at one point. They're a sound that was once recognized as crickets, but it fits the nighttime score here. So how do we get to this point? Well, we're actually moving backwards, so let me go one step back beyond this. So there's the step just before this is how we get to here, which is our audio bin. And we're right now in Midlands, and all these tracks you see here are here in its own folder, and each one of these has just what you see, what the name is. It has only that sound in it. So if I play this one, it has just the high arpeggio, absolutely nothing else. This one has just the mid arpeggio, and that's how we're able to adjust the volumes individually on each of the tracks over here. And I should be careful where I point there. So once all of these tracks have been created, then we just drag them in here and then adjust the levels. And once I show you how I do that in Logic, then I'll come back here and I'll do one from scratch just so you can see how it's done from scratch rather than looking at a finished project like this. So let me jump over to Logic. And this is the same file in Logic. This is the Logic project. Now, this one, if you just open it up and play it, you're going to get a cacophony. It's going to sound nothing like it should, because this is every track all the time. So here's day over here and here's night over here. And there's no logic going on. There's no game logic. I should use a different word. There are no parameters here. So everything is going to play regardless of what the happiness activity levels are eventually going to be. Logic has no idea that we're even going to do that. So the purpose of Logic is to go from the score that I'm have created in Sibelius, which we'll do next because that's the step just before this, and it lets me mix it and add sounds that Sibelius doesn't have. Sibelius, the way I use it, is almost entirely orchestral sounds, and they aren't always the best sounding orchestral sounds, so I usually take every track in, bring it into Logic, and then re-record most of them. Occasionally, they'll come out of Sibelius as is, and sometimes that works. Sometimes I can go directly from Sibelius and skip Logic altogether and go right into FMOD and then into Unity. And you can also start with just Logic and then go right into FMOD and then Unity. But this just happens to be the method that I use. And actually this one, I don't think this exists in Sibelius now that I think about it. No, it doesn't, because this one is almost entirely electronic. There are no orchestral instruments unless you count the piano, but in this piece I don't. All right, so basically what I need to be aware of as I'm creating this file is how these are going to be grouped. So I know that at some point I'm going to be hearing the high instruments or the things with a high timbre or things that are high in the note range. And so what I'm going to do now is select all of those and some additional ones that need to be there. But in this case, I've just had the high arpeggio, the piano, which echoes, so piano echoes, and then a highlight melody. Not highlight, but high light melody. And that sounds like this. So if you were just starting out and your happiness or your health was high, activity level medium, this is about what it would sound like. As we get darker, I'm going to solo the mid-range arpeggio, and then I'm going to put on a dark melody, which is just a lower synth. I'll put on a dark synth bass. And as I go down here, I'm going to un-solo some of the higher ones. So now I'm going to put on the piano. So now we're getting much lower. Now I'm going to put on the low arpeggio and fade out the mid-range. Now this is only for my preview purposes. None of this is going to be mixed in Logic. Okay, so what I've been doing just now, moving things around and adjusting what's soloed and what isn't, is simulating what FMOD is going to do in real time. So I can't move 21 tracks. Technically I can. I mean, technically I can move 21 tracks worth of faders, but I can't do it with any sort of meaningful result other than moving multiple tracks. What I need to happen is for the parameters in the game to move the tracks for me, and that's where FMOD comes in. So basically what I do from here, once I get this set, and I know everything is as close as I'm going to get it this time around. I always come back and make changes and then go back again. But as long as everything is mostly finished here, I'll just double check to make sure my range is set. I'll make note of my tempo because that's going to be important in FMOD. It's 90. And then I'll go export all tracks as audio files. And then it will do an export every individual track using its name. And I've already done that. And what I do is export, and it will have the track number and the track name. And I've already done that. And this is what I end up with. A list of files, one per track. And these are lossless, no compression AIF files, which is what I bring into Sibelius. And most of these are 24-bit, 44.1 kilohertz. And then Unity will do its own compression based on whatever is set in its settings. So here are all the tracks, the ones that we're going to bring into FMOD. Each one of these is only one instrument. So if I play the piano echoes, you hear nothing initially because there's an introduction. There we go. There's the piano. So FMOD is going to do all the mixing for this, all these individual tracks. And there's also, notice down at the bottom, there are four tracks called metals. One, two, three, and four. What this is going to end up being is a track that is made up of multiple tracks. And every time FMOD comes around to it, it's going to play one of these and only one. And the next time it's going to play a different one. It's going to randomize them. So that's what those four are all about. Those are down here. And let me just play you one of them. So there are four of them right here, and every one of them plays with this. So this is the bass sound for that. It's basically a crotale. And then we have metals 1 through 4 with the crotale. And each one of these is slightly different melody, except for number 4, which is very different, which is like a very high top note on a xylophone, I think, and then echoed, played multiple times to create this echo. You can hear it better if I turn the reverb off. So once out of every four plays, then that will come up. And it just creates something that makes the soundtrack vary even more, even though it's random, has nothing to do with the gameplay. Although it could. I mean, we could say, don't play this sound unless the happiness level is 50% or more, or between 60 and 80 or whatever. So, okay, so let's take this, and then I'm going to start a new event here, and I'm just going to call this one Midlands 2. Then I'm going to assign it to our master bank, and then I'm going to take these files. Actually, you know what? I'm not going to do it that way because those files are already in the audio bin. I'm going to create a new project here. Totally empty. And then I'm going to take these and put them into a new event. Assign to bank. Master. Okay, so I'll start with just the instruments. And drag that up here, and we should get 15 automatable tracks. There we go. Got one extra. That's all right. Actually, no, I'll keep that one because that'll be our metals. All right, so here we have almost an exact copy of what you have in Logic, where when you bring these files in, they're all going to play at the same time. So here they have we have the high arpeggio, medium, low. If I play, we have everything playing, absolutely everything. So what I'm going to do is, and sometimes when I build these, I'll bring in just one or two instruments at a time, but I just wanted to drop all these in just so they're here. And then I'll adjust them later if I need to. So now what I'm going to do is set the parameters on the high arpeggio. So right now we have no parameters set up. I'm going to have three eventually, happiness, activity level, and hour. But let's just do happiness here. So parameter sheet, new parameter. Actually, let's call this health because, no, let's not. Content, no. I can't decide. I'm going to call this health because that's a generic term and it fits pretty well. And we're going to be using a range of 1 to 100. Our initial value will be 100. And there we go. So this, unlike the timeline, is not temporal. This is a temporal timeline. This, when you hit play, it's going to go from left to right. Not necessarily in that order, but that is what you're looking at here, is a typical audio timeline. This is not a timeline. This is a range of 0 to 100 of the value for health. So as you hit play, you're not going to see anything move. All it's going to do is affect the health parameter. Here is where your playhead is moving. So, let's take, add some automation to the top three. Actually, before I do that, I'm going to put these two down, and I'm going to name these so I know what they are. High arp. And there probably is a better way to do this. I just don't know what it is yet. No, not April. Arp. Even though I've been writing music for like 30 years, I've only been using FMOD for, I don't know, full time for about a month and a half, but I used it a little bit quite a while ago, but never in this way. I used an older version of FMOD, but it was never used like this. At least I never did. Okay, so here's what we have. We have the high arpeggio, and we're going to add automation to it. So this dial right here, this volume, is going to change based on the value of health. And right now, it's a dotted line here shows that there is no automation set yet. So I'm going to put some points in, and then I'm going to raise this up to, say, -5 when the health is at this level. So 49 and above, this sound will play. So if I hit play now, get rid of that, and then there we go. Oops, I did the wrong one. I can cut that out. Maybe. Okay, so I'm going to undo this. Pretend that I never touched that volume level. Here we go. Here's our automation. So let's go from 40 to 50 on this one. It's a bit drastic. Okay. So now we have our high arpeggio, and I'm going to have it go from 35 to 75. So when the health is down here, it doesn't play. It starts slowly playing here, and then it's at the fullest volume is going to be when it gets to 70. Let's take this one, the mid arpeggio, and let's bring it up in the middle. Why not? So I'll bring that up here to about the same as the other one, so about minus 8, but not quite as high here or here. You can edit these curves forever. Okay, so here I have just the high, slowly bringing in the mid and taking out the high. Now the mid's full and the high is out. And again, this is our timeline, this is our parameter. So now I can add our automation to the dark, and that's going to come in down here. Again, minus 8. And these numbers really don't mean anything. It's really what you're listening to that matters. So these three tracks aren't necessarily at the same volume when they're all at minus 8 decibels. So you just got to use your ears, not your eyes, as Wendy Carlos said. Okay, so we have a dark arpeggio there, which to me sounds too loud compared to the other ones, just a bit. So I'm going to lower that, minus 10. Maybe bring it up a little bit in the last 5%. Oh, there's a timpani. I thought I muted the timpani. Anyway, so what I will do, there it is right there. I will repeat this process for all of these instruments and for each of the parameters. So I would repeat this process for the mellotron flutes at night, for the piano, for the dark melody, the bass lines. And that actually brings me to my next point. I have two drum tracks here, or rhythm tracks. They're not really drums. What I need for those is another parameter. And this one is going to be the activity. Again, 1 to 100. I'll start it at 50. So now these two drum tracks, which I'll play here. And I'm just going to call that beat 1. Beat 2. So these are pretty heavily affected tracks, and they're not going to come in until things get very busy. So this one is slightly less busy, so I'll have that one come in sooner. And then fade out up here, and then have this one come in here and max out up here. So let's solo those. So there's the top one, and there's the bottom one. Now here, we could have a little bit more of a mix. There we go. So if I unsolo these, now the other sounds are not being affected by activity level because I haven't automated anything but these two. One thing I do want to happen is I don't want to hear these drum beats unless the happiness is at least 50%. So I can add another parameter here. Well, I've already got it. I just need to use it. Right now I'm only using automation on the activity level parameter. So if I go to health and it's actually easier to think of it as happiness. But either way, health parameter, happiness parameter, I'm going to have these two beat tracks only come up if they're above 50%, and then they'll slowly fade in. So now we have no beats. Now the beats are here, but they're only going to be there if the health parameter is also where it needs to be. So think of these tabs here like and, health and activity level, and then and hour. So it's going to change both of these. And you could have an endless sheet here, but it becomes more and more complicated to mix these the more parameters you add. Okay, so that's five tracks. And that's not a bad sound so far. So let me go back to the other project, which is pretty much finished for that level. So here's the completed automation. Now, one thing, there's a couple other things that I want to show you in this. We had the metals. I forgot to put that in. Let's go do that now. Nope, not logic. We need to be back in FMOD. Let me just find out where I am here. Okay, there's FMOD. I'll cut that out later. FMOD. Okay. Okay, Midlands 2. Oh, that's of course, we're in the same file. I forgot all about that. So what I'll do now is just create a little bit of that from scratch. Cut there too. All right, so all right. All right, so one thing I want to show you here, this is the same kind of thing that we had before with the metals. I created multiple instruments and a random one plays. Let me just show you how that's created. So here's the track we use for this. Let's spell it right. How about that? Metals. Let me go back here. I have my four metals. And I'm going to put them not on the track header here, but in the track itself. And what it'll do is make one multi-instrument out of it. And then down here, you can see which instruments they are and what percentage each one has of firing. And we can also automate, we can set parameters so that this will only fire at certain times. But right now, there aren't any. So it's going to play every time. And it's going to play something random each time. So we don't need that here, but I do want to show you this one, which is a different version of the same thing. This one does have a parameter, and I'll solo that one so you can hear it, and we'll set that health happiness parameter down low here. So this is a multi-instrument that has little punches on it, little sound effects. And there are three different ones at varying pitches. So every time it goes into this loop, it will play a random one. So what this loop is called a despair loop. And whenever the happiness gets down to 5 or lower, wherever it is on the timeline, it will jump to the despair loop and stay there until it's 5 or lower. And a couple of things happen in the despair loop. It's actually just a regular section of the song, but the instruments change because obviously we have parameters. Happiness. So a lot of things happen when you get down to 5. A lot of the darker sounds start ramping up and all the higher sounds start going away. But in addition to that, there is a low-pass filter. And I'm still not sold on this idea. I saw this in a tutorial, so I used it and I kind of liked it, but I'm still not 100% sold on it. Before the game is published, we'll need to make a decision. But basically what happens is when your health gets to, your happiness gets to 5 or lower, the cutoff frequency gradually gets lower as well. So everything sort of fishbowls in and becomes this very dark, narrow, scary kind of sound. So let me show you that. Oh, I have this solo, that's why. Okay, so here we are. Happiness going down. So now we're less than five. So what should happen is, oh, let's change the hour. Less than five, we jump into the despair loop. We don't do it at night, it's a different logic there. So now we're basically stuck in this loop right here. And you're going to stay there until your happiness gets above five. But as you go lower, that filter kicks in. So you can hear it there pretty well. So here's the low pass. And I'll move the happiness. You can see the filter frequency change. And then eventually your happiness starts to go up and you can escape from the despair loop and go back to wherever it is you belong. In this case, it's daytime. So now I have the activity level way down and the happiness way down. So there should be very little happening there. Okay, that is a basic overview of almost the entire process. And if you stop watching now, you're not going to miss much. Well, you missed something. Cut there. What I'd like to do now is to actually do this process from Sibelius and show you a couple of different methods I use for getting written scores, notated scores, into a video game. So what I want to do now is just create a 4-bar looping section of music. Well, 8 bars, because I'm going to have the timeline shift as well. And this is going to be a section where, say, a player is wandering around, just sort of out in the wilderness, nothing really going on. And we want to write just a score for some atmosphere outdoors in the woods. And then add whatever instrumentation we need to make that darker and lighter and more intense and less intense. And usually the way I'll do that is by creating multiple copies of these instruments. So, for instance, and this just makes it easier in the mixdown process, I could, for instance, create a version of our theme in the first 4 bars and then repeat that and make it more complex in the next 4 bars and then repeat that and make it even more complex and then jump around. But it's a lot easier in FMOD to have multiple copies of the same instrument doing different things. So I'm only going to have 8 bars, but I'm going to have multiple copies. I'm going to have 3 different timpani here. So, and I'm going to label these because ultimately these tracks will be what Logic will call them and what FMOD will call them. So I'm going to have the timpani slow, timpani medium, and timpani fast. And I can switch in-game instantly between them. Like I can be going from slow to fast, to medium to fast instantly, like directly from one to the other, or as we did with the arpeggio, I can gradually fade between them. And if I do that, or if I plan on doing that, I need to be very careful what I do here so that there isn't any conflicts if you play two of them simultaneously. So for the slow, I'm going to do just a let's get in the right octave here. And this is one of those situations where I'm not going to use this timpani sound in the final product. This is a pretty lame timpani sound, so I'm not going to use that. And actually, I've got a kind of a bizarre echo going on here. Let me just see if loopback is causing it. It was. Okay, so let's create our slow. There's our 4 bars of slow. And in order to make this slightly interesting, I'm just going to create some dynamics. I'm going to have the first one play louder than the second. So here's our slow, and let's put a tempo marker in here. Oh, let's see. I would put in a generic marker, but I actually need to know the beats per minute when I get into FMOD. Okay, let's set this as 70 beats per minute. Let's see what we got. That's a little too loud for that first note. I'll just do mezzo piano. Okay, so there's timpani slow. Nothing but that. And now let's make this even more interesting. Let's make this F minor while we're here. Oops, I missed. F minor. Oh, duh. Okay, this is me completely forgetting what instrument I'm working with. This is a timpani, okay? This is a no-key timpani. When you look at an orchestral score, timpanis do not have keys. They just don't. So if I would have put a horn in here in addition, there's our F minor. Okay. We'll eventually use the horn. But this key change is clumsy because I couldn't see it. All right. There we go. That's what it's supposed to look like. So now we have a very slow timpani. And let's copy that and make it into a medium timpani. And by medium, I just mean slightly more rhythmically complex. Just very slightly. And I'm just adding very small accents here and there. Okay, so there's our medium timpani. I think I want to add a little bit more on these two notes. Okay, that should do it for the medium timpani. And now for the fast timpani, I'm going to get away from this rhythm a little bit because you can't get much more rhythmically intricate than that without changing the meaning of the whole phrase that we're writing here. So we're still meandering out in the woods. We just want a faster version. And actually, you know what? Before I do that, sometimes when I'm in sketch mode, what I'll do is I'll go over here and let me load up, bring this up here so you can see it. There's my, okay, here we go. My keypad. This is something that I use all the time. This is on my number pad on the keyboard. Anyway, so what I'm doing now is I'm adding slashes to the notes, which are technically tremolos, but listen to what it does. It, in this case, it's an eighth note, but it takes an eighth note and adds a slash to it, which creates a 16th note. So it's the same thing. It creates the same thing as if I had, oops, let's get to the right pad here. So that's the same thing. That rhythm is the same as this. It's just an easy way to create a little bit more rhythmic complexity without renotating everything. So let's just make sure that's going to work. It probably won't exactly. Oops, I was going to play just one of them. Yeah, that works. For this example, anyway, if I was writing a production score, I probably would spend more time on it, but I'm not. Okay, so one thing to check before we go on is to see if there are any issues in playback here. Sometimes you have phase issues if you have two samples playing at the same time, but they're not quite together. Let's see. Yeah, what you heard just there, that was a phase issue. That it takes the sound, the waves that kind of interfere with each other, cancel each other out in certain places. And it's not always a problem, because most samplers like this use round robin techniques that don't repeat samples, but it's not perfect. So what I'll do is bring this into Logic and then create a timpani based on a much better sample and use that, and it won't be as big an issue. Okay, so there are our three timpani lines. Let's add some more instruments to this. I'm not going to get really crazy. I do want some bassoons in there, but before that, actually, let's use these horns here. And I need three horns, because I'm going to do... Actually, no, let's do two horns. Two horns are going to work with three timpani, starting with this one. And I'm going to put a mute on there, and they're basically going to double it. So this is very, very, very simple, like Beethoven-style timpani and horn, although Beethoven probably would have used a trumpet. Oops, let's do only the ones that we want here. That's not bad, but you know what? I think it's going to work much better for us with a trombone. So we'll do two trombones, and I'm going to also put them down an octave. And then I'm going to get rid of the horns there. All right, so let's take a listen to this. And with the trombone, I don't want the mute. Okay, now for the second trombone, this is going to be the medium version. Let's see what happens if we just play what is going on down there. Yep, that works. All right, now let's add some strings. And I'm only going to add a couple here. Well, add a whole string section just because I like to be able to look at it. But I'm not going to be putting in stuff for every instrument. I'll start with the violas. We're in F minor, so I'm going to just do a little thing. Oh, that's too fast. Oops. And down an octave. And I want slurred. I want to go from piano to mezzo forte and back again, just because that'll give us some dynamics to work with. Do the same with the cello, except I'm going to reverse the dynamics. And this sounds like this. And the reason I did that is, after working with sample libraries for so long, you get sick of hearing stuff like this. That sounds really awful. And I can compensate for that by using the same pitches but on a different instrument and varying the dynamics. And I can even add one more level to that on a different instrument. And then make this one come in a little bit quieter. So that's not bad. But now what I want to do is add some intervals here to make this a little bit more interesting. Okay, so now I want to hear this with just the slow version of the other instruments. Okay, that works. Now let me hear it with the fast version. Actually, let's put the trombone on this one. I may have to put a third trombone in there. Yeah. But for now, I'm going to fill these in with repeats. Just for the sake of composition, it's easier to work with. Okay. Now, we are ready to put in a melody. And I'm going to have this come in on the second bar. And it's going to be very, very simple melody. I'm just going to start on the dominant and go up. And then go down with triplets, chromatically. And then... so a very simple melody. We'll start off piano, work our way up to mezzo piano, and then back down at the end. Just hear that. That's okay, but some of the notes are not quite right. Should be better. Almost better. I think I'm going to... okay, let me just see what we got. I think we can get away without too much chromaticism here. Okay, I'm going to add an octave to that. And I'm also going to add molto vibrato. And I think I need to be up to mezzo piano by the time I hit this note, because that C tends to get buried. What I'm also going to do is I'm going to double this on the flute, at least one octave anyway. Oops, picked the right one. So I will double the upper octave. Actually, you know what? I think I'm going to double both. Okay, let's take a listen. Before I go that far, I'm going to save this just so that in case we lose power or something. No way, man. Okay. Let's see what we got so far. Now, I can't just play this anymore. I have to be selective. So I'm picking my fast. In case you're wondering about these are obviously the fast strings. And I will duplicate these and create slower strings a little bit later. So now I'm ready to play this, and there we go. Better. Okay, I just heard something there that I like and I want to continue, so I am going to repeat these bars and make it into an 8-bar phrase because I think it really needs to be. What I heard was as soon as this got down to here, I pictured another instrument taking it up. and repeating it, specifically the horn. Horns, I should say. Possibly horns and trumpets. I'm not sure yet. I'll put them both in there just in case. I usually don't start with a full orchestral score when I write stuff, just because it's too much, and I don't always write with the same instruments. Occasionally, I'll start with a piano score, but it's very rare. Only when I'm working on like really, 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 really long projects like opera or orchestral music, I'll start with a keyboard score. But I prefer working with the instruments because you can hear them, you know. So here's the flute part. And let's listen to that. Actually, what I'm going to do now, just to make my life easier, is I'm going to go to the mixer and I'm going to mute everything that isn't the one that we're interested in hearing. So the first trombone, I don't want to hear. And the first and second timpani, I don't want to hear. So I can just hit play now and have a medium version or fast version of this going on. Okay, here we go. Let's go from here. So now we have the flute doubling the violins. Okay, two things is the violins are too quiet and the flutes are too loud. But we can compensate for that by just making the violins louder. And when I say violins, I mean just these guys here, not the rest. Okay, so now that other section I told you about that I want to add to this. That is another instrument. That is the horns and trumpets. Oh, this is another good point that I should mention. You see these red notes? What Sibelius is trying to be ever so helpful in doing is showing me that the notes that I am writing in this staff are out of the instrument's playable range. And frankly, I don't care. This is never going to see the desk of a conductor. It's never going to be played by an orchestra, as far as I know. So what I can do is actually play these instruments way beyond their ranges. Now, technically, this is something that, you know, being a composer of 30 years, I should know this. And I do, but they're being helpful and they're showing me that this is not cannot be played by a French horn if you write it like this. Okay, but unlike most sample libraries, the one that I'm writing with right now, you can play instruments well beyond, above and beyond their range. So in this case, this C, I can keep going and bring it up another octave, and then down low. So I can play this in any octave I want to, and then know that this computer can play it back the way I want to hear it. Anyway, what I want to be doing now, oops, I put molto viv. I meant molto vib. No wonder it didn't sound right. Molto vibrato. That's better. Okay, molto vibrato here. Okay, so here's what I heard. And then instead of repeating the melody I just heard, I'm going to repeat a fragment of it and then kind of compose with it. And again, I'm out of the range of the horn here. So let me see. How am I going to do this? Okay, and then I'll go up to D flat. Okay, so I want triplets here. Not there. Here. Okay. And yes, this is incredibly sappy. I mean, beyond sappy. But that's okay, because, you know, sometimes you gotta be sappy. All right, so there we are. There's the horn line. Let me just put this. All right, so let's listen to this. Ooh, that's not quite right. It wants to go back down to C, but I don't want to. I want to go back up to C. Maybe I do need to go up to E flat like I originally thought. Oh, there we go. Yeah. So D flat. Da da dee dee. D. See what we have there. That works kind of, but. Again, I'm not aiming for perfection right now. Actually, I can go back down there. That might work. Nope, because that wants to go down to C. This might be a bit much. We'll see. Yep, very much too much. Oh, you know what would work better here is a triplet. Make it a little more relaxed. And then I could do a triplet here as well, and that'll make that more relaxed. Let's try that. There we go. It's not perfect, but it will definitely serve the purposes. I'm going to double it up here on the flute very quietly. Now, in a real orchestra, you couldn't do this. Well, you could, but it would be tricky. The horn, especially if you were to try to convince somebody to play this part at this range, it would have to be so loud that a flute played at piano would be drowned out completely. But I know this sampler, so I know that it's not going to be. I'll just add a little sweetness to the horn. I'll bring it up one more level and you can hear it a little more clearly. It just adds a little bit of sweetness to the horn. Here it is without the flute. Here Here's the flute by itself. Together. And what I'm also going to do is increase this to mezzo forte down there, because as a flute gets lower in its range, whoops, it gets quieter. Even a sampled flute gets a little quieter. All right, so let's play it from the beginning. And there we are. I think the only thing missing here now is something in the bass to just bring this all together. And I think what I'll do is do a little rhythm in the bass here, sort of on a 2 and 3, just to kind of get some movement going down there. So let's see, I'm going to start. Oh, wait. We're still there. Okay. That might work. It might not. Let's try it. No. You know what I'm going to do? Let's start by just sticking to tonic and dominant. But I might change that as this progresses. Well, let me just listen to it. I don't want much. It doesn't need to be complicated. Mezzo piano will be enough. Yeah, that works. That actually is a little too loud there. I'm going to take this just for kicks, get rid of the molto vibrato, reduce the level, put on the trumpet, see what we get. Hey, that doesn't need to be. That's better. Trumpet is too much. It is too much. The horn is better, but still not quite there. Oh, I know one thing that definitely needs to be changed. Here, if you listen closely, you'll hear the flute. The high note on the flute is piercing, beyond piercing. It no longer sounds natural. So I'm going to remove that note entirely. And then double it on the piccolo, which is much more appropriate. And that way I can get those higher notes without so much volume. And actually I can just stay right at piano there, the whole thing. And yes, I'm out of range again, but you know what? That is not needed there. It's only on the first one. Okay, this should be better. And actually, this can go back down to piano. No, let's keep it there. Okay, Now this sounds like the end of a phrase, but this is making it sound like it's not. So I'm going to do this. See if that helps. That's better. And then I'll do that down here too. Okay, I think that's probably enough. I now have enough tracks to work with to bring this into FMOD, or bring it into Logic, rather, and start making it sound like the piece it should sound like. It's not. It's pretty amateurish at the moment. Oddly enough, it's only one instrument right now that's causing it to sound amateurish, and that's a timpani. It's just a. It's not a very good timpani sound. I don't like it at all. So I'm definitely going to replace that when I get into Logic. All right. So I'm not going to do any more on that. We have 70 beats per minute, which we'll need to know. Well, we won't need to know it until we get into FMOD, because Logic will already know it. One thing I realized just now is that I had yet to create my three different versions of the string section. But I'm actually only going to create two. I don't necessarily need to create a slow, medium, fast. There's no rule that says it has to be three things. It could be slow and fast, or it could be medium and faster medium. It could be whatever. I mean, I could do 10 different levels per instrument, but there's really no need. At least there hasn't been a need yet. Maybe there will be in the future. I'll have 20 timpanis and 20 violins and 20 violas and... Anyway, so yeah, what I'm going to do now is just make one copy of each of the violins, violas, and cellos that are doing those runs, and then ostinato, that's what I'm looking for. And then I'll make a simpler version, because this is kind of the busy version. So let's do another violin, two, viola, cello. And just making sure that it's going to put it in the right place, okay. And this is a really easy way to do this, too. All you're going to do is go up here and change those to eighth notes. Same with our viola. Change them to eighth notes. And cello. Eighth notes. So now let's rename these. Violin 2 slow. Violin 2... Yeah, we'll call it fast. It's not really fast, but it's faster. Slow, fast, slow, fast. And let me just solo the slow. That was the opposite of what I wanted to do. I wanted to listen to just the slow guys here. I may need to adjust something on it. Yeah. So what I'm going to do is put some accents in here just to make the performance a little more interesting. Yes, you heard that correctly. Here I have a case of random accents creating a sense of life in music. I've got three of the same passage at the same octave in three different instruments, and notice the accents are different on each. This one has accents on 1, 2, 3, and 4. This has on the end of 1, 2, 3, and 4, and this is every third eighth note. So putting these three together, the combination of the changing dynamics between the three of them and the changing accents between the three of them results in... A little weird sounding, yeah, but usable. Because remember, you're not just going to be sitting listening to this music. I don't have your undivided attention in the game. Here, maybe I do, but... When you're playing the game, you're going to be focused on a lot of other things, not just the music. So, and you know what? That makes me want to change these a little bit, just to put an accent here or there. Let me just listen to this. No, I think that works. Maybe just an accent on 1, 2, 3, and 4 in one of the voices, just to bring it out a little. Yeah, that's not bad. Okay, so now I'm going to unmute everything, because when it comes time to mix down tracks, Sibelius uses whatever settings you have in your mixer, or it can. So I'm just making sure everything is roughly at the same level. And then under Home, we have Export Each Staff as Audio. And then if you had things like pianos in here where there were multiple staffs put together, then you have the option of exporting multi-stave instruments as one audio file. So, no way, man. So, the name of the, this is going to be the name of the audio file that is generated, which we will then bring into Logic. So, I'm just going to throw this on my desktop in a folder called No Way Man Files. And then go. And then it's going to go through each one of the instruments and export a file for it. Then we can close Sibelius. And the only time we'll need to come back to Sibelius is if we decide in Logic or FMOD that we don't have what we need. We need to come back and either create a new instrument or make a change to an existing instrument, something like that. And then we need to re-export it, bring it back into Logic. But I don't normally find myself going back as far as the original score. I try to be as complete as possible, and in fact overcompose in the original score, because I can always cut stuff out in Logic. And that is it. For more complex scores, this could take a really, really, really long time. This is only 8 bars of, you know, a dozen and a half instruments. Yeah, this can take a really, really long time. But fortunately, that's it. The only other thing I need to export from here is a MIDI file. I don't need to export it, but it's really handy to have. When I open up a file in Logic, okay, that's that as a MIDI file. I'm going to get rid of that. And now open up Logic, and let's create a new project. And then we'll create an audio track. And then we'll bring in the tracks that I just created. Let's also check our metronome marking 70. Okay, so actually, you know what? I don't need to worry about that yet. I just told you that. Yes, I know. You just said you don't have to worry about that yet. So on my desktop, I have these files and all kinds of interesting things here. Wow, I'm really busy. All right, so I'm going to bring the MIDI file in right at the beginning, and it's going to ask if I want to import tempo information. Hopefully it'll ask me that. Nope, it's just going to do it. Okay, fine, just do it. I need it anyway. So now what I have is the exact MIDI notes of what I was just working on in Sibelius. But now it's inside Logic, and it sounds like crap. Oh, it doesn't sound like anything at all. No, it does, because you're hearing it, but I'm not. Hold on a sec, I gotta bring up my loop back. There we go. This sounds like crap. Oh man, that's just painful. Okay, so the first thing I need to do in Logic is, so that it doesn't interfere with what I'm doing, I'll go to each track individually and then get rid of the control from the MIDI. I don't need any volume, pan, sustain, reverb information at all in these tracks. And having them in there will just interfere with what I'm trying to do when I'm mixing it. So I'm just going to go through them all and get rid of that. And with Logic, once I configure one type of track, like the timpani, I can just copy and paste it to the other tracks. And there's my double bass. Okay, so that's everything clean. I'm going to save this project. No way, man. Okay. So now I'm going to mute everything except the instrument I'm working on. And what we started with was completely orchestral, but this is not going to be completely orchestral. I'm going to add a few things to it. But first, let's take care of the important stuff, like the instrumentation. But the first thing I'm going to do is, since some of these have EQ and samplers and things on them, I'm actually going to clear out all of these channel strips. Just reset them so that there's nothing on them. And then except for the audio track, I'm going to put on an instrument. And no, I'm not. Let's do this one instrument at a time. Sometimes I can get away with putting in multiple instruments on multiple tracks, but this I'm going to do one at a time. So I'm going to start with a timpani. And I'm using the East-West Composer's Cloud. And here are the libraries I have installed. And for the timpani, I'm going to use the Percussion Gold. And here there you go. And I just want, I think the short should do it. And find out if that's going to be long enough. Yeah, that'll be plenty. So now I'll unmute that. So that's effectively solo. That's the only thing playing right now. And that is a much better timpani already. Okay, so I'm going to put some basic compression on there. And one thing I like to do is, for timpani, this is just the sound that I like. I'm actually going to take a compression setting that was meant for a drum. Of course, meant for a drum. Meant for a drum kit. And that's the Opto Toms preset here. I just like the way that it works. I'll generally need to change some settings, like the threshold especially, and the ratio. It's a nice tight tom setting. Tip setting. But another thing I can do is, and we'll frequently do with timpani, is I'll actually use a floor tom EQ on it. And that takes gives it a lot of punch, gives it a lot of character. If you listen to the difference with EQ, without. So there's our EQ for timpani 1, which is timpani slow. And I'm going to copy that and paste it to the other two timpani. Medium. Fast. Now, one other thing that I usually do when I'm working in Logic is I'll take the time to change the icons, or if I have a preset, which I'm not going to get into right now. I do have presets for these, but I'm just showing you the process from scratch. The ideal thing would be to be able to just drop all these into one Logic template, but I don't work with the same format every time. I always end up with a different count of instruments in different orders. So that wouldn't necessarily be the most effective for me. Anyway, here are our three timpani. And I'm going to mute all but the fast one. And for now, I'm only going to show a couple of these instruments. I'm not going to go... This video will end up being 12 hours long if I don't. So I'm going to do just the timpani and the strings. So there's the three timpani taken care of. Now I'm going to drag this over and this and this. Just change the settings. So we're on our first, we're on violin 2. So this is a rhythm violin, so it's a fairly short instrument. Actually, you know what? I'm going to save us even more time. Now, normally, yes, I would go through and replace each one of these with a very high quality sample. But one thing I just remembered, well, I didn't just remember it, but I just remembered to use it, is that I actually have all of these as audio files. So what I'm going to do first here is just hide the ones I don't really need. So here are the three timpani tracks and a double bass track. But then what I'm going to do is open up our audio tracks and then put those in. It's going to ask me where I want to put them, create new tracks. And we should have one track per instrument. Boom. And then our file names are there. So let me just mute our sampled instruments and play just these. Okay, one thing you probably noticed there is that when I hit play, there was a delay. That's because I was using the Note Performer sample set in Sibelius, and there is it's like an AI playback system. So there's a 1 second delay on everything. So what I need to do is take all of that and move it back to the beginning so that it's in sync again. And I should use the metronome to make sure that it is. Okay, so here are our individual files that we brought in from Sibelius. And I'm just going to pretend for a moment that I didn't create these, because it's just a simpler way to show you this. But each one of these does have a preset. Some are built into Logic. Like this one here is built into Logic. And all it is typical compression and EQ settings for that particular instrument. So this is a typical piccolo EQ and compression setting. This is without, and it also puts in some reverb buses. That's straight from Sibelius, and this is the preset from Logic. So let's grab a few of these. I'll just go through all of them. There's our flute. French horn. Trombone. We have two of these, so I can just copy and paste that one. Timpani. No, I'm going to get rid of these timpani, because those are terrible timpani. I'm going to put these down here, where they belong. There we go. Okay, so there's a timpani. These, now, keep in mind that these are sampled instruments being performed inside Logic, and these are audio files that were mixed down from inside Sibelius. So all I did was replace the horrible sounding timpani from Logic, I mean from Sibelius, and replace it with this much better sounding timpani from Logic. And eventually, if this were going into production, I would replace probably 50% of the instruments here. 50% or more, just because it would sound so much better than the composition score. Now, it is possible to compose inside Sibelius and have to do any of this in Logic. But this is a less than a few month old installation on this Mac, where I just recently upgraded. And so not everything is in place and ready to go, because Sibelius can sometimes be a pain in the butt to set up to sound really good right directly from the score. It's meant mostly for notation, but it is possible to configure it so that when you play the score, it sounds really, really good. But I just haven't had time to reconfigure my Sibelius to do that, which is why we're reconfiguring things inside Logic. Okay, so let's get our main violin in here. This is our screeching, soaring. And I'm not going to need to do much to this. I'm just going to put a little bit of compression on this. And I'm just going to use a squeezed to start with. That'll stand out just fine. So then we have two more violins. No, not two more. We have one, two, yeah, two more. Then we have violas. And I'm pretty sure these are settings for solo instruments. But for our purposes here, that doesn't matter. Once I get my presets all back in, it'll all make sense. Okay, so now cello. Violoncello. We got two of those. And then a double bass. This might be listed as a contrabass. Contrabass. There it is. Okay, that's everything important. Except for this. What is that? Oh, that's a double bass. Yes, let's put that down there. Because I am going to do something with this that shows up in a lot of Peace Island soundtracks. No, I'm not putting dubstep sounds in there. Where is it? I guess I didn't put it in there yet either. This is also a fairly new installation of Logic. But it's based on the subby bass. So I'll start with that. And that sounds like this. May or may not be at the right octave. Probably isn't. Yeah, too high. Very, very, very simple bass whose only purpose is to rattle subwoofers. That was three timpanis at once. Now the timpani also sounds like it's at the wrong octave. Oops, that's not the timpani. Timpani, here we go. Nope, it's not. It just sounded odd. Okay, I think we're ready. Let me just play this subby bass for you. Oh, I just did that. Okay. Now, again, we're not mixing here. The only time I ever mix here is if I want to create a semi-polished version of this to share on the web, to put on the Peace Island soundtrack or my own website. But it's still not dynamic. I could actually do a capture straight out of Unity or FMOD Studio, but just dragging the sliders around, and that would showcase the whole score a lot better. The reason the metronome is important isn't because of Logic. It's because of the way things are divided and calculated on the timeline in FMOD. I need to be able to tell FMOD to snap to a quarter note or a measure or two measures or whatever, so that when the transitions occur, if I want to jump from this part of the score to this part, it's going to happen musically. So it'll wait till it gets to the end of the bar and then jump to where I want it to go. And if you don't know the metronome marking, you can't do that very accurately. I mean, you can do it. It's just a lot easier with the metronome markings. So, okay, let's suppose that we have spent hours and hours and hours in here, which is usually what it takes, sometimes a day or two, to get all of these parts together. This is actually a relatively small score. One of the bigger ones that I did is for downtown, which is the biggest area in the game. Excuse me. The downtown area in the game is the biggest and is the most complex soundtrack with the most pieces. And that one, I think it's got 50, 60 tracks in Logic. But anyway, we have enough tracks here to work with. So we'll take these tracks and export them. And I'm going to get rid of some things I don't need because I'm not going to be using them all. Okay. And let me just double check my timpani, make sure that they're all playing nicely together. Okay, that one almost didn't play nicely together. Okay. So now, first, let me just double check my project length. Otherwise, I'll have very long audio files. That's good enough. It doesn't need to be a clean ending to your file. We can only use a piece of it. So if your file is this big and FMOD, you only need to use this part. You can just ignore the rest. So now, file, export all tracks as audio files. So now, I'll go back to my folder in the desktop, and I'll make a new folder called FMOD Tracks. The name of it's going to be the number and the track name. Export. Depending on how big your project is, this could also take a very, very long time. And that's it, we're done. Okay, so now we're ready to go to our next step, which is FMOD Studio. When I say FMOD Studio, that's to differentiate it from the FMOD that's integrated into Unity, which doesn't look like this. It's all in the code, and that's next. Anyway, so here we go. This is No Way Man. To assign this to our master bank, then we'll take our files, FMOD tracks. And now here's an interesting thing. Notice that some of the files are missing. Some of the names are missing. And that's just because those are muted and hidden. So they don't show up. So the numbering is a bit weird, but that doesn't matter. As long as they'll import, that's all we need. And there we go. There's all the files from Logic. And again, if we play this, it's going to play everything. And I don't want it to play everything. So let's start by just creating an activity level, because that's really the only thing we composed for. Okay, so let's go up here and let's work with the timpani first. So timp slow. Temp medium, temp fast, and then activity level, add automation. So now we have three automated tracks for the timpani. For slow, let's make them about 33% each with a little bit of crossover. We'll know in a minute how much crossover we can afford. So there's the slow down there. Here's the medium from there to about 65-ish, something like that. And then the fast will fade in there. Let's take a listen. This should be just slow. And let me go solo these tracks so that we're not distracted by anything else. Slow timpani, medium timpani. And let me just turn off that echo. All right, so we are in FMOD. There we go. Medium to fast. Now, the thing to check here is to make sure that in the places where they cross over that they mix well. To hear that little bit of a phase issue. So what I'm going to do is make these crossovers as small as possible so that the game spends as little time as possible in them. And another thing I'm going to do is create a loop region here because I want this to keep playing. I'm just going to assume it's going to loop over the entire piece for now. Actually, let's do this the first 8 bars. And we need to put a metronome marker in there also, because it doesn't know what how long the bars are. Let's see. If you'd let me put that down there. Tempo marker. I said, what was it, 70? Just double check that. I'm pretty sure it said 70. Yep. Okay, so 70. So now, when you play it, these bar markers will make sense. So if I hit right on 3, it should start right on the third bar. Okay, so now we can add our loop region. Just over the first 4 bars. Now, let's go all the way. Let's go all the way to there. Okay. So that's all set. We get our timpani all set. They're all 3 levels. I'm just going to adjust this crossover so it's not, it doesn't take quite as long to get there. There's our fast timpani. Okay, cool. Now let's do the strings. And I will start with, well, the violin I'm going to leave as is because it's pretty much going to stay there no matter what. Although, I might just decrease the volume a little bit if the activity level goes way down. So if you're down at the point where you're going to hit that despair loop, you don't want this soaring, singing violin over the top. But this is activity level, so we're not worrying about happiness yet. Okay. Timeline. Let's go next to our violin. Our 2 violins here. Actually, what is this one? Yeah, that's our second violin. And then viola. What is this one? Okay, that's the medium. Violin, medium, violin fast. And then we'll do the same with the viola and cello. Viola, medium, viola fast, cello, medium. I meant to make those abbreviated. Doesn't really matter. And then cello fast. Let me just double check. Okay, so now I'm going to solo the slow ones. Now I'm going to solo all the strings so that I can get the automation in there. Okay, so now we have activity level automation for these strings. Whoops, it's already there. Okay, so starting up at a medium. And this is 50-50. I'm going to make this pretty much all of these guys just start to fade out at 50% and get to nowhere. The medium ones. I'm sorry, that's the opposite of what I wanted to do. I wanted the medium ones to fade out up there. Okay, so here is a fast one. And let's just try these 2 to begin with. Okay, medium down there, fast up there, medium down here, fast up there. This is not an exact science. I'm just setting the initial values, and then we can change them from there. So medium there, and then fast down there. Okay, so now we have the medium and fast for the violins and strings. These should all be medium. And then fast. Mm-hmm. Now, you've got almost everything. So now I want to hear the timpani and the strings. Now let's change the activity level. And there you have it. Now, when you get to this stage, assuming that you've done some setup already, like so this is actually an existing score that I use in Unity. It's the one that I played earlier. So No Way Man is literally spelled like that in Unity, if you want to refer to it. But first, what we need to do is build it, because all of these files have been added and need to be put into the project for Unity to be able to access. So after we build this, we go into Unity, and it will... That's not Unity. We go into Unity here. It's importing the audio files. And then, once it's done doing that, we double-check the console, and it's updated Unity. Down here it says it's updated our information, so we have the latest score, which means in Unity I can then go over here and search, and there's my No Way Man right there that I just created. So now when I play this, we can control the activity level here for No Way Man, and obviously we can add this later on in our and have it do everything that the other scores do. So there we are, neutral activity level. Slow activity level. The happiness does nothing because we didn't program those parameters. Busier. And so on and so forth. And that is the entire process. Please comment and like down below if you like this video and you think it's worth a comment. If you want to hear more or see more of this kind of thing, comment down below and let me know what you'd like to see. If there's any part of this demo that you want to see more of, if you think it was useful to you, then let me know and share and all that good stuff. Thank you very much. Bye.